So for the design of any equipment, we need large number of design parameters. Gas fraction, liquid fraction, solid fraction, gas solid mass transfer, gas liquid mass transfer, liquid liquid mass transfer, heat transfer at the wall, heat transfer near the coil. Name any equipment, we need design parameters, and the procedure I have been telling you, that is try to get empirical correlation in the literature. There is nothing better than that available. And then for a given multiphase system, do few experiments in the laboratory and try to adjust the proportionality constant. That procedure, is it clear to you? Yeah. Today, the entire time I am going to spend upon why we are empirical, why we chemical engineers are empirical, that is why we have not understood the rates of heat transfer, mass transfer or momentum transfer at the interfaces, and why do we need to make such experimental measurements and then develop correlations. This entire presentation will be sent to you, but I'll try to explain to you the reasons. So next, we have seen up till now variety of equipment. I am reproducing here some of them. The bubble column, where there is a sieve plate and bubbles are sparged through a pool of liquid. So this is pressure energy type of equipment. Fluidized bed is also pressure energy type of equipment. Then comes kinetic energy, agitated slurry contactor, or anyway, any agitated vessel or stirred vessel is kinetic energy type. So typically I have shown here, this is white wipe film, means potential energy type, and this is also structure packing, is potential energy. Typical 4-5 equipment are shown, and there are several empirical correlations for every equipment that I have been telling you. But what is the current status of those empirical correlations, that I want to tell you. Next. Next. Yeah, next. Don't get afraid of anything. If it is a current status, it is a current status. Yeah? So nothing to be bothered, because we are making ourselves comfortable by doing some experiments in some size of the equipment. So we need not worry. We need not worry. We need not worry means there is a methodology to go ahead, design the equipment, scale up the equipment, but we should be clear enough in our minds that the prediction without any assumption, the value of heat transfer coefficient coming from the total understanding, that is not possible at this stage. And why it is not possible, that is going to be the main subject of today's lecture. So here you can count how many correlations are there. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 and 14. 14 correlations are there, and there are approximately 2,500 data points. Estimated overall gas holdup, that is in a bubble column, in a bubble column, you pass gas and note down the what is the fractional bed expansion. You can always measure. So, extent of expansion divided by the total dispersed height is the fractional gas holdup. That can be done. So, this way, in the literature, about 2500 data points are there. Now, you take any one symbol, like say the first one, this one. So, as compared to experiments, if the experimental value is 0.2, what is predicted is 0.1. If experimental is 0.5, it predicts anywhere between 0.2 to 0.4, right? So, that is about that symbol. If you take plus, where is plus? I am unable to see. Oh, yeah, Nakanov. So, plus is here, plus is here. So, if experimental is 0.7, what is predicted is 0.2. Now, you can see some other symbol, say triangle or open circle. So, the whatever correlations are developed, there are typically three problems. One is, in the laboratory, the experiments are done normally with the systems which are readily available, and the range is covered, particularly the column diameter or vessel diameter or impeller diameter, the range is covered, whatever can be covered in a university laboratory. Right. So, maybe maximum vessel diameter covered in the university is 1 meter, or we had 1.5 meter, but 1.5 meter. But the commercial diameters can be 7 meters, 10 meters. And in one of the problems which we had solved, it was, I think, 7 meters. So, the practical range of geometrical parameters or practical range of operating parameters, they are outside the range of the experiments which are performed in the laboratory. This is a well-known reason, and you must have heard this from many teachers. That is, the extrapolation to the larger scale is not possible. Not possible means what? In bubble column, the I had drawn flow pattern inside, and there is a upward flow in the center and downward flow near the wall. And I derived a very approximate equation in the class regarding circulation velocity, which is equal to square root of 2g into height of dispersion into epsilon g. That was the equation. Now, heights covered in the laboratory are maximum equal to laboratory height, correct? No? Maybe 10 feet maximum. But commercial columns, the problem which we solved was 29 meters, and the floor height 10 feet means 3 meters. So, 29 meters is close to 10 floors. That cannot be done in the laboratories. So, what happens? The circulation velocity, even if holdup is the same, which I told you is independent of column diameter, 2 epsilon g into height of dispersion into g, which is equal to circulation velocity, this is the equation which we had written earlier. So if actual height is 7, 8, 10 times, then the commercial velocity is also 3 times at least. So if we are wish to know heat transfer coefficient near the wall, now in the large column, the velocity close to the wall is 3 times more, and we try to predict it on the basis of the laboratory column. This is one reason. The other reason is the actual systems, say gas liquid or liquid liquid or gas solid or gas liquid, these are never studied in the laboratory. Forget about simple properties such as viscosity, density, etc. But more difficult physical property which cannot be measured till today is surface property. I mentioned to you last time that if you take tap water and distilled water and take bubble column of 150 mm and take height of say 2 meters and pass the gas velocity with superficial value of 0.1 meter per second, right? We don't get identical answer. But if you want to see how much is the difference in terms of perhaps in the tap water, there may be some dissolved solids, but there are normally some surface active impurities which get accumulated near the interface, and therefore the actual performance is different. The third reason is, maybe I'll explain that reason. Let me repeat two reasons. The commercial size equipment in terms of geometry, in terms of dimensions, are far larger than whatever can be investigated in the laboratory. And the extrapolation is not possible mainly because the flows are the scale of flows. If you say take upward velocity and downward velocity, and that the circulation pattern, if you take the pattern size itself, or the first eddy created, that eddy upward downward is up the size of 30 meters. Whereas in the laboratory it will be 1 meter, 2 meters, maximum 3 meters. So 3 meter eddy size is going to be do something different than, and therefore extrapolation is not possible. This is the first reason. Second reason I mentioned to you that there are some surface active properties which physical chemists, we can consider ourselves also. We have not understood how to measure such properties. Even if you take water and add few drops of any alcohol, right? So there is practically no change in density, practically no change in surface tension, but still that small quantity of alcohol gets accumulated near the interface and imparts the property of non-coalescing. That is, if two bubbles come together, they repel from each other, they just don't coalesce, right? So these non-coalescing agents, this property really cannot be. Therefore, what I have recommended is take our actual system of gas and liquid and do the experiments. That solves this particular problem. But I'm explaining you why so much scatter is there. Two reasons I have already explained. The third reason is, take any correlation, and the well known to all of us is say Dittrich-Bohler equation. So the heat transfer coefficient near the wall multiplied by diameter divided by thermal conductivity, that is Nusselt's number, is equal to 0.023, Reynolds number, that is du rho by mu raised to 0.8, Cp mu by k raised to 0.33. So this is one correlation, right? Now if you see in this correlation, heat transfer coefficient is proportional to thermal conductivity raised to 1 and thermal conductivity raised to minus 0.33. Or this is proportional to thermal conductivity raised to 0.67. Just for explanation purpose, let me do mu also. So H, the heat transfer coefficient is proportional to viscosity raised to minus 0.8 and viscosity raised to plus 0.33. So the overall effect is mu raised to 0.47. Minus 0.47. So here the limitation is, and this is also important limitation, whatever may be the diameter of the column, whatever may be the range of viscosity, either like water that is 1 centipoise or 10,000 centipoise, for all the possible ranges of viscosity, heat transfer coefficient is always proportional to 0.67, right? Let me explain it using some other words. That is, the dependence of heat transfer coefficient on conductivity is unique irrespective of column size, irrespective of superficial velocity, irrespective of viscosity. In reality, what happens, such proportionality constant is there, but it may be 0.6 for certain range of viscosity, it may be 0.72 for another range of viscosity. So this constancy that we have forced, we have done certain experiments and we tried to make dimensionless numbers like Reynolds number and Prandtl number in this case, and we try to get one exponent for all those experiments. And in the laboratory, typically if you see any PhD thesis, there will be approximately 500 points. And in the range of those 500 points, there is a scatter, of course. There is a scatter, but within 10%, a correlation is developed. So these are the three reasons, very important reasons, because of which the empirical correlations, they do not give accurate predictions of the design parameters. So therefore, such a big scatter is observed. Now what is shown on the parity line, are these pink? This pink, yeah, the pink circles. So using artificial intelligence, the same data, all the data have been correlated in some other manner. What it says is the dependence of heat transfer coefficient on every property for every point is unique. Why artificial intelligence? So many relationships are there, no? So therefore, all these relationships, the computer the language is called machine learning, you must have heard. So we teach the machine that these 2,500 points are there. So when this is the diameter, this is the superficial velocity, this is the viscosity, this is the CP, then this is the value of heat transfer coefficient, right? You take another point, but the machine which learns, it remembers all those relationships individually. And this way, we teach the machine 2,500 times. And this is the reason why artificial intelligence, it really eliminates all the internal, the dependencies which I mentioned to you, that unique dependence of heat transfer coefficient on thermal conductivity. There is no unique dependence here. In fact, the machine does not develop any dependence. It just tries to see that these are these many points and these many points have these many properties. Perhaps there may be some other parameters which are not included here, but you have, you know that mu upon mu w raised to 0.14 is sometimes added in addition to that, correct? What is not included here is roughness, correct, no? The roughness of the pipe. Now we try to use this correlation, we really don't know what is the roughness of the pipe and we keep on using it. Now depending upon the roughness, and I will refer to that roughness from a few minutes from now, that the roughness itself is a turbulence promoter. And whenever there is a turbulence, there is a transport in addition to molecular diffusion, molecular conduction, and molecular viscosity, we have eddy diffusion of viscosity, eddy diffusion of mass, eddy diffusion of heat. This gets added because of roughness, and in the rough pipes we get more pressure drop, we get more heat transfer coefficient near the wall. And but this roughness, do we have any measurement? If you want to do in great detail, that is whatever heat exchanger we have, let us measure the roughness and use that correlation perhaps, which includes the roughness. But after measuring the roughness, then and give all this data to machine learning. For machine, it doesn't matter. You can give 30 variables, 50 variables, 100 variables, and 2500 points or 5000 points. It remembers all those. It remembers means not remember really. That remember is not a correct word. That is the relationship between the design objective, here heat transfer coefficient, on whatever it depends, all that relationship as a number it is trained, machine is trained. So if any other number is required, heat transfer coefficient is required for any other viscosity and any set of thermal conductivity and CP, it scans really again through all those parameters and tries to give the best fit. But it does not assume whatever assumptions are made, that is we can make dimensionless numbers, that is not required for machine learning, or whatever properties are there which cannot be measured, that also it doesn't consider, right? So this is one level superior than the empirical correlations. But what I have told you, if you don't have the AI based correlation, whatever I have told you is pick the correlation from handbook or a book and do experiments in the laboratory. So as far as your class is concerned and my teaching to you is concerned, all the design parameters are estimated by picking up one who writes the chapter in handbook is considered as sufficiently expert, having an experience of 35 to 40 years, and then he really compares all of them over a wide range of parameters and then makes recommendation. So we begin from that recommendation and do experiments using the system for which we are going to design commercially the equipment. Is the procedure clear? Very clear. Should I explain again? Yeah. I like that. I think the I say this in public lecture, I like new generation. 30 years ago, while I was teaching, nobody would have said that I have not understood. Nobody would have said. But as a teacher, you develop, I'm not moving these days in the classroom, But whosoever says, yes, I have understood, and if I say the face, any teacher, not I as a teacher, quickly understands whether it is really understood or not. The faces are very, very transparent. But saying it positively that I have not understood, where is the problem? Yeah, there is a problem. And even if I explain now again, and if you again tell me that these parts are still, it is not understood, right? So, okay. First of all, whenever we design, how many cases we consider back mix, back mix, back mix, plug flow, plug flow, back mix, plug flow, plug flow, non-ideal dispersed phase, non-ideal continuous phase, correct? So all the cases we have considered. We know the differential equations which govern the flows, and we can always write the rate of mass transfer or rate of chemical reaction. And then in an actual equipment, if the reaction is exothermic, we need to take it out. So if we write energy balance for the equipment, there is a certain enthalpy which reactants carry inside, the enthalpy which leaves the equipment, and the heat which is generated, which is taken out. And therefore, we need heat transfer coefficient. The summary of whatever I said in last 2-3 minutes is, we need good number of design parameters for every equipment. We need interfacial area, we need 2 mass transfer coefficient, gas side, liquid side, and the droplet size distribution. We need all this information. So these are called design parameters. For the estimation of these parameters, there are empirical methods in the literature. We can say empirical or semi-empirical. By semi-empirical, we mean that we develop some dimensionless numbers, and generally heat transfer coefficient is proportional to Reynolds number raised to 0.8, generally, correct? So development of some understanding with the help of dimensionless correlation. So instead of empirical, we give a word semi-empirical, right? Little away from semi-empirical, right? So these correlations for heat transfer coefficient itself in a pipeline, how many correlations you know? Any other you know? Cedar tat, right? Anyone? Anything else? We are talking about only forced convection. So you go to any transfer book, you will have a variety of correlations. Means what? The proportionality constant will be different. The exponents will be different. More or less, it will depend upon Reynolds number and Prandtl number. So in this manner, the heat transfer coefficient relatively is well behaved. But here it is the gas hold up in bubble column. So the bubble column, the gas hold up is a function of superficial velocity, right? And then maybe mildly dependent upon the sparger design in terms of number of holes, the diameter of holes, right? Then the viscosity and density of gas, viscosity and density of liquid. Then surface tension, the column height. So all these parameters are there, and from these parameters, all these investigators must have developed some dimensionless numbers and recommended a semi-empirical correlation of this type. And if there are plenty correlations for one particular parameter for multiphase reactor, the handbooks or the books, they give 1 or 2 on the basis of their own experience. So for practicing engineer, the practicing engineer is not supposed to evaluate the performance of all the correlations and select the one, correct? So we select the best one. Among the best one, what is available, there will be some Reynolds number, there will be some Froude number, there will be Attefors number if the surface tension is there. So on the basis of that, all those exponents are there and proportionality constant is there. So we pick that correlation and obviously get the value which is there in hand, but we don't believe that value. We believe the exponents and we don't believe the proportionality constant. So whatever equipment I have told you in the class, take jet loop reactor, sparge loop reactor, the plunging jet reactor and rotating disk reactor and the bubble column and the sectionalized bubble column and packed bubble column and internal loop loop reactor and external loop airlift reactor. So I can keep on saying another 10 equipment, the names of which you know by now, correct? So that equipment we built in the laboratory, and whatever I am saying is the recommendations in terms of the minimum size. If bubble column, we want to do hold up experiment, I am saying 150 mm, right? Don't take 25 mm or 50 mm. In 25 mm, if you pass gas, there is a possibility of slug flow. The regime of operation we never see in the commercial plant as far as bubble columns are concerned. So therefore, for a size, we do our own experiments in the range which is an operating range at the commercial level, and whatever answer we get, that answer will be different than, likely to be different, maybe 20% different, 50% different, 80% different, either less or more, and then we try to adjust only proportionality constant for that purpose, and then say that this correlation, we ourselves in our plant may do chlorination, sometime later we may do hydrogenation. When chlorine is passed through toluene at a superficial velocity of 5 cm/s, we may get hold up of 10%. If we pass hydrogen, then we may get hold up of 14% and not 10%. So using the actual system, we perform the experiments and try to adjust the proportionality constant, and then that correlation is supposed to be good for that particular liquid-liquid, gas-liquid, solid-gas system. Is it clear now? Yes? Or which part you want explanation? Anyway, the part 4 is difficult. Part 4 is difficult. So if you have understood after explaining 2 times, or I might have explained little bit previously, then also I will give individually 100 out of 100 marks if you have understood. So raise your hands, those who are getting 100 marks. Even if you are not understood, you are getting 100 marks. What is not understood? How the empirical correlations are developed in the laboratory? That part is not understood? Yes? No?
Yes.
That is understood. The limitations of those empirical correlations, the 3 reasons I gave, are they understood?
Yes.
Right.
Okay.
The 3 reasons. First of all, let us see how many things are not understood. We perform experiments in the laboratory. try to collect the variables. This dimensionless analysis, is it covered in the class?
Yes.
And the development of variety of dimensionless numbers, and they have certain physical significance. So can you tell me 10 dimensionless numbers? One at a time. Reynolds number, yes.
Sherwood number. Schmidt number.
Are you, somebody should keep track, huh? Should not get repeated. Nusselt number. Fraud number. Prandtl number. Another four. Weber number. Very good. Stanton number. Very good. Very good. Pecle number. We learnt recently. Which one? Grashof number. Now, since you told 10 very easily, I would have said tell me 5 more now. But the point is, we develop these numbers on the basis of which property is important and which is, of course, obtained through experiments, right? And then the relationship between the Nusselt number, in which there is a heat transfer coefficient, is supposed to depend upon on the basis of experimental data, on Prandtl number and Schmidt, on Prandtl number and Reynolds number. We don't write here Schmidt number, right? Now that is easy. Yeah. So such empirical correlations are developed. The second part I said was, such empirical correlations, they have 3 limitations. One is geometrical parameters which are covered in the laboratory in terms of length, in terms of diameter, in terms of roughness, or whatever geometries are possible. We don't consider all the geometries in the laboratory. You imagine roughness as a parameter which cannot be measured very easily, then whatever pipe we get in our laboratory, whatever pipe we have, we do experiments with that. And maybe we will not get exactly 0.023 as a proportionality constant. We may get some other constant. But if we get some other constant, then that holds for that pipe. Correct, no? So the geometries, those which are used in the laboratory, cannot be extrapolated for all possible geometries in the plant. Obviously, the plant dimensions are going to be big. The commercial means it is going to be big. The pipelines are of 20 centimeter diameter. If these are transport pipes for the crude oil, that can be 1 meter in diameter, 2 meter in diameter, right? So those dimensions are different. Physical properties are also likely to be different. And that physical property, by which I meant, whatever can be measured, we can make dimensionless number. There is no issue. Whatever cannot be measured, these are surface active impurities which govern the rate of coalescence or rate of breakup of bubble into small pieces. This part is unknown. And I gave you just 2 examples, and I can give you many other examples. You put salt inside, which I gave perhaps last time. Salt inside, and then the holdup will be 20% more than whatever we have in water. You add alcohol, right? You add some glycerin you add, then the values are different. And some of these impurities, the difference between surface, the tap water and distilled water, is not that much in terms of property. I'm sure you'll get density is equal to 1 in both the cases, and viscosity is equal to 1 Cp. That is not an issue. So this difference is not taken into account in empirical correlations. And the third number is, all these correlations, they assume a unique relationship between the design objective and any one parameter. The way in which I showed the relationship between heat transfer coefficient and thermal conductivity is always raised to 0.67. I am myself unable to see what I have written. And you people are able to see it? Very nice. Raised to 0.67, right? But in reality, these relationships can vary between say point raised to 0.55 to 0.75. And that makes a big difference in if we want to design a column and if you don't have an accurate value and which is 30% we have taken excess, then our dimensions are more by 30%. So we have over designed by a factor of 30%. So therefore, one more improvement, I'm just explaining it to you, it is not widely used, and this is now called is generation 4 chemical industry, which is going to use the data analytics. You will hear this word again and again on the basis of these are the techniques originally developed by electrical engineers on the basis of pattern recognition. That is, they measure current with respect to time, and if certain pattern is observed, from that they try to understand what is the cause. But picked up by computer engineers quite extensively, and in their undergraduate program, data analysis itself is a subject, data analysis. And then they have various methods. There are statistical methods. Similar methods are learned by students who are in the area of statistics. Not exactly same, but similar data. Can you understand the share price with respect to time? Can you understand that? Share price? No. Okay, let us not take that example. All right. Vegetable price with respect to time? Right? So now sometimes vegetables are not available because of the transport strike, say, for example. All right. So there is a data, vegetable price with respect to time, and there is a pattern, right? That sometimes it is high, sometimes it is low. Within a 7-day period, there are fluctuations. So what the data analysts, they try to do is try to locate the price versus time, which can be attributed to transport strike. Right? There, how many reasons are there for any vegetable becoming cheaper or costlier? What are the possible reasons? Season. By season, we mean perhaps not sufficient rainfall. Correct, which we are going to face now, the next April, May, June, and the prices will rise. That is one reason. What is the another reason? All kinds of, that is, from the farmer going up to the consumer, whatever logistics the logistic points are there, all those reasons are there. Plus, tell me one more reason. Imports, yeah, imports is a good. The import may not be related to vegetable, for example, but we are generally discussing prices with respect to time. Now, if you want to buy benzene, definitely benzene is imported, right? And if benzene is imported, large quantity, then have you learned the subject economics? That you will learn chemical engineering economics, the economics which economics students learn. Have you learned that subject? Those subjects are removed. When I was an undergraduate, we were learning 4 subjects which were not apparently related to chemical engineering. One was pure economics. The second one was logic. The third one was social philosophy. What is the meaning of communism, meaning of socialism, the meaning of democracy, right? And related to that was total subject. The fourth one was English. Perhaps that is there. Huh? English is there, yeah. Which is the title of which is changed perhaps and said communication skills. it is in the form of communication skills now. That is the written and oral expressions, how to do that. So we are drifting. Coming back to economics, there are, the machine tries to understand if there are several reasons. You know, traditional way of diagnosis of disease, that is pulse examination, you must have heard at least.
Yes.
Correct. So to the practitioner, this particular pattern of pressure versus time is related to certain disease as per their science, right? So here is a diabetics, here is a heart, here is a cancer, here is something, and here is an ordinary fever or overeating. So all that can be recognized with the help of patterns. So these patterns in the pressure versus time. So similarly, if you measure current with respect to time of the motor of the reactor, right, and current versus time for all the equipment, you measure pressure versus time for all the equipment, and whatever variables are there, you measure from everywhere, then suppose sometimes we get production, the plant is supposed to give 50 tons per day, but sometimes you get 52. Sometimes you get 47, sometimes you get 45. So all these measurements which are there in the control room. Have you seen control room? Or you are in still third year, no? You will see the control room when you go for the practice. So all these are available variables. They are measured with research. So what machine does, it just tries to analyze how many patterns are there. And then what is fed to the machine is, now yield is 87%. Yield is 92%. Capacity is 52 tons per day. Then it tries to relate within the productivity versus all the variables in the plant, right? Including the ambient temperature, right, ambient humidity, the cooling water available for the process, and all the variables. So it is machine learning means sufficient data are fed to the machine. It tries to develop internal relationships. And whatever patterns are there, those patterns are recognized and they are attributed to certain reason, right? So this particular activity is becoming very, very popular, very sparsely used in our country. And in developed countries also, this technique is developing. It's not still developed in a good manner. But chemical engineers and computer engineers, they are coming together. Similarly, you have seen the Amazon. So what they do? The computers in ICT are purchased, 10 computers per day. And something else, and something else. And how many items are Amazon sold as sales? So of them. And then in Tamil Nadu, they are sold in this manner. So all those patterns it tries to. So what I'm trying to tell you, our problem is much simpler than Amazon. Right? Those many articles are not there. Here I don't see any one shirt matching with any other shirt. I can take my word back if anybody tells me that two are similar. I see two yellow, but they're not same yellows. Yeah, they're not same yellows. So this much variety is there. That much variety is fed to the computers. And then Amazon, why it is making big business? Because data processing, it is capable of understanding. So accordingly, say if you keep certain stock, yellow shirts, you keep 10,000 with you, right? So any time you ask, there will be yellow shirt. 10,000 shirts is going to cost something, say I'm saying 10 lakh rupees. So that money is locked. We take money from by rent, from interest paying to the, and then the business doesn't work. So they optimize in this manner. So there, the overall objective in their case is profitability, right? Overall. Here our objective is also profitability, but we express in terms of yield, purity, productivity, in terms of, and try to see how it depends upon different variables. So it is one step better than the empirical correlations, but it is not yet readily available. We tried in our class in order to give feel for what is artificial intelligence. It was not taught in a totality. But now when you go to the plant and when the artificial intelligence will be used in a big way, then you will get exposed. So that is the second. The reasons, three reasons I mentioned to you is the geometrical and operating parameters covered in the laboratory on the basis of which empirical correlations are developed. There is a vast difference. A unique relationship is assumed, that is the second. And third one, the different systems, multiphase systems, cannot be characterized only by measuring physical properties. There is something even more than that, and that more than that is some impurities, the concentration of which, at least that cannot be measured, or the effect of that on surface activity, that cannot be measured. Right? And therefore, we perform experiments in the laboratory using the actual system, and then we get much reliable. Even if you remember this, you will do much better job in your respective practice. It is much better now as compared to first explanation. Yeah. But I want to teach to you today where is exactly the difficulty. More or less I have been talking about up till now is most of the sentences are qualitative. I want to tell you quantitatively where the problem lies. Correct? Next. So if you see the interfaces, when you solve parabolic velocity profile for laminar flow, you assume that velocity near the wall is zero, correct? And that is called no slip boundary condition. Slip, there is no slip. Whereas when gas bubble rises, then between gas and liquid, total slip is assumed, correct? And then there is a total slip or free slip, and there is a no slip, and in reality, there is intermediate slip. This is one problem. Next. Now I'm beginning to explain to you what exactly we wish to solve. What have been the attempts, perhaps right from 1876 till today, what has been the objective while solving that problem, and where we are, and where we are heading up to. This is what I have promised you. And I'll explain in a simple language. So here are Nusselt number versus Sherwood number data divided by Reynolds number, and what is plotted If it is the Nusselt number, then it is Prandtl number. If it is Sherwood number, then it is Schmidt number. So Schmidt number is varied from, or Prandtl number from 0.1 to 10,000, and these are the experimental values given by some number. So just collected experimental data. And this has been done by Matpati sir. He collected all this data. Okay. Next. This part we learn. So the quantity transferred in heat transfer is heat, in mass transfer is mass, and in momentum transfer is momentum. And momentum, the flux is expressed as tau w, the flux is expressed as either kilocalories per meter square or watts per meter square, and in terms of mass, the kilomoles per meter square. The physical property, the molecular property is viscosity, conductivity and diffusivity. If it is turbulent flow, then it is eddy viscosity, eddy conductivity and eddy diffusivity. The coefficients, the friction factor, the heat transfer coefficient, the mass transfer coefficient, which we are trying to get. What I am trying to tell you, the similarity between the transport phenomena. What is the driving force? Here it is velocity gradient, the temperature gradient and the concentration gradient. How it is expressed? We have seen the Fick's law, but Fick's law is for mass. When it is heat, the description is similar, but written first time by Fourier, therefore Fourier's law, and this is given first time by Newton, and therefore Newton's law of viscosity. But flux is proportional to concentration gradient, temperature gradient or velocity gradient into proportionality constant, which is respectively given by viscosity. And the rate of transfer is, in terms of flux, heat transfer coefficient into delta T, mass transfer coefficient into delta C, and the friction factor into this driving force. Next. So if we measure near the wall, if we are capable of measuring near the wall, what exactly is the flow pattern? All right. And there are methods of flow visualization which are there in our laboratory also. So what is being done? Near the pipe, there is flow is occurring. Or say there is a channel, two plates are there, and between the two plates flow is occurring. And we measure the flow pattern near the, in the vicinity of the plate or in the vicinity of the pipeline. I mentioned to you that wherever there is a velocity gradient, we start stirring with the help of spoon, we put impeller inside, bubble rises, fan starts. Whenever there is any velocity gradient, then eddies are generated, all right? And then these eddies break and these eddies break further. So in any flow, there is eddy size distribution, and for any size, there is a velocity distribution. So this picture, that is photographed by a professor from Stanford, here you can see that there is a size distribution as well as velocity distribution. That is the one. I think that is a good idea. So whenever flow is occurring, so are we able to, I'm now going to tell you the conclusion of my lecture, though I'm not concluding. I'm going to conclude again by same sentence, this complexity of the flow, how many structure dimensions are there? And they are breaking, and their location from the wall, it is changing. unless we capture all the details of such a flow pattern in the vicinity of the interface, this sentence you are not supposed to understand, right? Unless we understand the details of the flow pattern in the vicinity of the interface, we are not going to understand the transport phenomena, correct? The same sentence I will say again at the end of the lecture, at that time you are supposed to understand. So right now the complexity is expressed by the motion of eddy size distribution, and for each eddy the velocity distribution. And while eddies are flowing, they are breaking, perhaps coalescence is also occurring, two eddies are coming together. And can we mathematically, can we solve this mathematically? That is the issue, right? And Sachin Matpati sir, he solved up to certain thing which I am going to tell you, and that his PhD was completed in 2007, that is 12 years ago. And after 12 years, what has happened till today, that I will, but let us see what happens. So next slide. So actually I wanted to derive this on the board, but let me try. I think you have been, you are being taught using the projection, no? That is not written on the board, but only with the help of projection it is taught. So I will try today. I very rarely use teaching with. Whenever we plot velocity with respect to time, we can always write velocity is equal to average velocity plus fluctuating velocity. The concentration is average concentration into fluctuating. So these are the three components, UVW and temperature is T bar plus A. Are you getting this? Yeah. And then stress is the combination of the molecular part of it, viscosity into velocity gradient, and this U prime V prime is the stress because of the eddy motion. And we write this as plus mu t times U prime V prime. I think I'll explain few things, because explaining everything will become difficult. You imagine this is a pipeline and flow is occurring, and there is a velocity profile. The flow is turbulent and there is a velocity profile. And you take two levels. So the velocity here, there is a velocity profile and there are two velocities. What we are saying, whenever there is a turbulent flow, it consists of the eddy size distribution and velocity distribution, right? So when an eddy from this location of certain size, it moves and comes to this location, for example, right? Here the velocity is less as compared to this velocity. So here the momentum that it is having is mass into velocity at this location. When it comes here, it tries to attain mass into velocity at that location, and whatever extra momentum it has, it sheds away. And that is called momentum transfer, correct? Likewise, there can be momentum transfer. The another eddy of some other size can come here. And in this manner, the eddies are moving. Now here what happens? The momentum transfer is in such a way that momentum is gained here. So obviously, whenever we say momentum transfer, there is a net transfer, but it is in both the directions, the momentum transfer in. So whenever this AD comes here, suppose this value is U1 and this value is U2, correct? When AD from here comes here, then temporarily if you are measuring velocity here, then it will be U2. So when velocity versus time is plotted, then we get such measurements. In a turbulent flow, we get these measurements. So when this comes here, otherwise it was average flow, and after AD coming from here to here, it went down to this value. So suppose you take few milliseconds later, some other AD may come here, and the velocity increases, and this is the real pattern of velocity versus time, or temperature versus time, or concentration versus time. So here U1 minus U2, that is delta U, is a fluctuation. And fluctuation has happened in the axial direction, in axial direction. So suppose you call this as, there is a UX prime. What has happened is, this is the UX prime, all right? Now the transfer has occurred in this manner. What really happens here? There is a fluctuation in y direction also, uy prime. The mass transferred, the momentum transferred is the mass of this, that mass, that is the volume of this into velocity of this, that is momentum transferred, and the delta u is the extent of and multiplied by the length. Maybe I will simplify this. Delta u is equal to u1 minus u2, correct? And the L times du by dy is equal to this delta u. L times du by dy is equal to this delta u. Now that tells about the delta u part of it, correct? So multiplied by u prime, the v prime, is the amount of momentum transferred. So this v prime and L into du by dy, so the velocity gradient into the length is delta u, which is u prime, into v prime, that becomes the momentum transferred by turbulent mechanism, u prime into v prime. Even if you understand this, some 10%, 20% is acceptable to me as far as today's lecture is concerned, right? So this u prime v prime is the stress. It is the stress. It is the momentum transferred per unit area. Therefore, what is written here is u prime v prime multiplied by density, that becomes the mass multiplied by velocity and momentum transferred because of turbulence. The heat transferred because of turbulence, the concentration mass transferred because of the. Then we are making this dimensionless, tau upon rho, q upon rho Cp. Go ahead. There are certain substitutions. The first one is the combination, the overall stress transferred is combination of molecular transport plus turbulent transport. And turbulent transport now has been written like molecular transport, the molecular viscosity plus turbulent viscosity. Now there are certain substitutions, u prime and v prime. And after those substitutions, we get equation 8, which are further modified. I am going to circulate this to you next. Similarly, we can write for Q, whatever we wrote for momentum, we can write for Q. And therefore, Q versus Q at the wall, Q is at any radial location from the interface, and then it is a combination of molecular Prandtl number plus turbulent Prandtl number. Next. So this algebra is that way simple. The overall final answer is rho Cp into temperature difference, that is wall temperature minus bulk temperature, into U tau, that is the fluctuating velocity near the wall, divided by wall flux, is equal to integration of this. Now the problem is, or it's okay, the next one is the some modified version of the same equation. The problem is here, since the eddy motion is not known, the nu t is not known. It cannot be calculated from first principles. And the overall problem lies here. See, molecular viscosity into velocity gradient is easy to calculate, right? But when we want eddy viscosity into velocity gradient is easy part of it. But we need to know eddy size distribution and velocity distribution, then only we can calculate the value of mu t. And here is all the problems of empiricism, either for mass transfer, the eddy viscosity for mass is required, either for heat is required, or momentum is required. And all those cannot be calculated because prediction of that is not possible with the present status of knowledge. So therefore, what is done? What is being done from 18th? Finally, we want to solve this equation, but in this equation, nu t is not known, and there have been several attempts. What is being done from 1876 is, while integrating this equation, we make simplify the flow or assume the flow, right? So next slide. So this is the first attempt, which was in 1876. What is the assumption he made? Whatever may be the flow, how the engineers make the assumption? Whatever may be the fluid, Prandtl number shall be 1. That is 1876. Because of that, what happens? When that is integrated, that is Prandtl number, turbulent Prandtl is also 1, and when it is, everything is substituted here, finally what we get, Nusselt number is friction factor upon 2, Reynolds number and Prandtl number raised to 0. If anyway all the fluids are having Prandtl number is equal to 1, we are going to get PR raised to 0. So what happens? Next slide. So the prediction of Reynolds is blue line, whereas all the data collected are here. So where is the problem? The Prandtl number, which was assumed to be equal to 1, was molecular transport, right? The turbulent transport, there was no effort made. And therefore, the answers are quite different from whatever are the experimental values, right? Therefore, the next attempt, next. So this is the in this approach, what is done is either velocity profile or nu t profile is assumed. Instead of Prandtl number is equal to 1, either with the help of measurement, or there is some other reason which I will tell you shortly, the different velocity profiles are given, or different eddy viscosity profiles are given, or different stress profiles are given, and purely empirical relations are established. So say, for example, take next slide. See, the Prandtl and Taylor together, what they assume that the flow near the wall is completely laminar up to y plus is equal to 5. This you have of course learned irrespective of Reynolds number. Let the velocity be 1 meter per second or 10 meter per second, the thickness of the laminar boundary is y plus is equal to 5. So with that y plus is equal to 5, the same equation is solved and we get Nusselt number is equal to whatever is the final equation, we get this answer. And this answer when it's converted to the comparison with the data, next slide, then it can compare up to say Prandtl number of 20, but when Prandtl number is 1000 or Schmidt number is 10,000, the Prandtl has been able to. So what does it show? The Prandtl tried to make little progress. That is up to at least some region is totally laminar, some region is totally turbulent. What Reynolds had assumed was the entire region was turbulent. There was no laminar region at all. But since near the solid surface, the velocity is zero. Wherever velocity is zero, at least their Reynolds number is zero. So when Reynolds number is zero, no transition has occurred. So at least in some region, it should happen. So that recognized was by Prandtl, but it could give. But beyond that, you must have derived universal velocity profile. That is the velocity is laminar up to y plus of 5, between 5 and 30 it is transition and beyond 30 it is turbulent. And that is proposed by von Karman and Martinelli put together. Next slide. So up to 5, this is yet another, that particular slide is missing, but instead of Prandtl number is equal to 20, it could do a better job up to 40. But still, we have data up to 10,000. So there is a Russian scientist called Levitch. What Levitch said, the interface between laminar and transition and turbulent, that itself depends upon the Reynolds number. So he took from near the wall, y up to delta 1, it is laminar flow and nu t is 0. From the first delta 1 to delta 0, so instead of von Karman, who assumed the transition from laminar to transition at y plus of 5 and from transition to turbulent y plus of 30, those boundaries Levitch made it flexible because of reality that they are not fixed values. But while the reality was being incorporated, what should be the distance from wall where the first transition occurs and second transition occurs, that he correlated empirically. I'm trying to tell you, and the summary of the overall lecture I'm saying again, since fluid mechanics in the vicinity of the interface, this is difficult to understand, describe mathematically, therefore the problem lies. So we started with total turbulent flow of Reynolds, little bit laminar sublayer Prandtl, laminar sublayer plus transition layer plus turbulent flow, that is von Karman or Martinelli, and we have come to Levitch. So if you see the Levitch, the next and this is the solution of that equation. Nusselt number is a function of friction factor and Reynolds number and Prandtl number. Next slide. And here you see a very good, but why it has become very good? That is now the heat transfer coefficient for a particular Prandtl number is known. And the values of transition from laminar to transition and transition to turbulent, those values of delta 1 and delta 2 are empirically found. right now. So whatever is not known is empirically established. And same thing you will see in variety of correlation. This is a group, Lin et al. They assumed variation of nu t, nu t close to the wall is zero, and how nu t varies with respect to length, that is given. Next. So the summary here is, all these developments, they assume certain quality of fluid flow, assume, not really find, not understand. And on the basis of that, or even I can make a statement, since the answer of heat transfer coefficient is anyway known, the velocity profile assumed is in such a way that it gives good prediction. So Lin, then next is Deisler, and then the friend and Metzner, and then, so in all these cases, see now here, 0 to y plus is equal to 45, nu t varies as nu, a is a constant, b is a constant, and the exponent is also there, the values of n is equal to 3 was given. So all these are empirical. So how nu t changing from wall to the bulk is assumed, correct? No? But one good thing is, for what assumption we get good answer, that at least is known, correct? No? So when slowly measurement started, next slide. This is just yet another. So we can keep on going. The basic point is, the flow in the vicinity of the wall. I would have liked to derive this in the class, but anyway, I'm circulating it to you. Next slide. So the computational fluid dynamics tries to understand the flow at all the locations, everywhere in the equipment, and whether we are better placed in terms of getting these transport coefficients, right? So the computational fluid dynamics, it tries to solve the momentum balance, the equation of continuity, equation of motion, and equation of energy, right? So basically, we should be getting T prime, U prime, U prime, V prime, C prime, U prime, right? Whatever were unknown. But these themselves, T prime, U prime, they need a lot of knowledge. So when computational fluid dynamics typically started early 60s and started exponentially increasing, exponentially means it was fairly close to x-axis, but exponential. If 10 papers were published in, then 20 papers, and this way there was exponential. But what is the present status? In all the forms of analytical theories, and that too for pipe flow, please remember we are designing a commercial equipment which is multiphase, and we are describing complexity for pipe flow, right? And the pipe flow problem and some of the problems I'm going to describe to you what is the current status, that is also very much simplified. Though several sincere attempts were made, the experimental as well as computational fluid mechanics were not sufficiently developed to reveal the physics of fluid flow in the vicinity of interfaces. This is the difficulty. Design correlations for reactors such as stirred vessels and fluidized beds. This third point says, this is the difficulty even for pipe flow. So forget about the real equipment, where there will be much more complexity, right? Next slide. This is the reality. And what is done? Prandtl says up to y plus is equal to 5, it is laminar flow, then it is turbulent flow. None of the reality is taken into account. And unless that is done, we are not going to get design parameters from first principles. Next. There is another way of doing it, rather than velocity profile or stress profile. There is another way of heuristic approach. That is, eddies, eddy motion is assumed, and eddy comes from the bulk, comes to the interface, picks up heat mass or momentum, leaves the interface and goes back to the bulk, right? And the first theory in this direction was proposed by Higby, that is in 1935. So the next slide. So the Higby's theory was first, and what is seen there? Next slide. The somehow the eddies are represented by those blue balls, and the vectors which are drawn, they say that the flow is laminar there, and turbulent eddies, they come only up to a certain distance from the interface. Until then, there is a laminar convection, like laminar sublayer. But this is the picture which Higby visualized. And for this, he derived the equation. I have given the detailed derivation, but the final answer is very simple. Next slide. Is very that is, heat transfer coefficient is rho Cp. This is thermal diffusivity, that is K upon rho, divided by contact time, that is the AD staying at the interface. For how much time it stays, that really decides the. So theory is good. The point is, we started, we did not know heat transfer coefficient, and he gave the relationship between heat transfer coefficient and the time for which the AD stays at the interface. So this was not known, so this is also not known. Correct, no? So basically, there is an effort to understand. The problem is not solved. But what we must appreciate is the effort itself builds up. The builds up. So next slide. So the previous one. So these eddies, what the Higby says, that it comes to the interface, it stays for some time. So from blue, it goes, becomes some other color because of perhaps mass transfer, perhaps heat transfer, and then it goes away. And it can be expressed. Though the period for which it stays there is called Tc. And for what is the assumption? All the eddies are of same size. All the eddies are of same size. And all of them stay for same time. I told you the thesis, PhD thesis of Higby was of 30 pages, including introduction, conclusions, references, including everything. But this was a big development at that time, 1935. The chronologically, please try to remember only one sentence. The problem is complexity of fluid mechanics in the vicinity of interface, which I have tried to show you with the help of those motion of eddies, how complex it is. And what is the chronological development right from 1876 to understand the flow of interface at the interface, and therefore how the development is occurring. That is the overall subject. So what you should understand is the development is occurring continuously, are the number of assumptions which are being made, those assumptions are decreasing, the mathematically you will be able to understand. So slowly how the subject was developed. So then Dankwartz, that is the teacher of Professor Sharma, what he assumed, that this is not a good idea, that all of the eddies are staying for the some time is not a good idea. So he assumed certain age distribution, right? A single contact time is not a good idea, but distribution of contact time, this is a reality. But he gave a certain age distribution. Next slide, that is Dankwartz. This is the derivation of Higby's theory, what he gave in his thesis. So maybe these are 4 or 5 pages of Higby's thesis. Next slide. So let us go further. Those who are interested, that is the final equation. So what Dankwartz said, That is, all of them, they do not stay for some time, same time, and then there is a age distribution. Next. This is yet another theory, that is small eddy model. That is, in the vicinity of interface, the eddies are always present, and whatever streamlines are shown, that is the flow pattern. As per that scientist, whatever he understood means he assumed this flow pattern. Right? The next. That was a small eddy, means all the eddies which are in the vicinity of interface are of the size of 5 microns, and large eddy model means all of them are greater than 100 microns. Next. So this is the velocity profile which I mentioned to you, and I tried to show that whenever there is a rise or fall, eddies are coming and going. So the span over which there is an average velocity, that can be considered as contact time, which gives the age distribution. Next. This is yet another way of describing. That is, the eddies are not only moving in one direction, the eddies are moving in the parallel direction to the wall. So the surface divergence of eddy dispersion is calculated. Next slide. So Higby and Dankwards, I have not explained really. In principle, I told you, basic principle, there is an eddy motion, and eddies are permitted to go right up to the interface, and there is nothing like laminar flow. Whenever there is an eddy motion, means there is a turbulent flow. It may be decaying turbulent flow, but eddies move from bulk to the interface. Next slide. So instead of constant age and the age distribution given by Dankwards, which is shown in the next slide, so this particular orange line is the age distribution given by Dankwards, and the black line, that is the constant age, is given by Higby, and therefore the Perlmutter, basically what he said, this is also not correct, this is also not correct, therefore he assumed a variety of age distributions in his analysis. In his analysis, what is the sensitivity? So what Sachin did, he included all these in the analysis, and how much is really the difference? And he found that in the next slide, that varies only by 13%. So why make so much fuss of these exactly the same R distribution, this distribution, that distribution, that? So this is, unless the Perlmutter did something, Sachin would not have been able to do anything. Correct, no? So that is how the progress happens. Next. Then, now the further one is, the eddies cannot go right up to the wall, and there is certain laminar layer. What is this? The film penetration theory. That is, there is a film, as well as some eddies go right up, don't go right up to the wall, they stop there, and some eddies go right up to the wall. Next. And the eddies, they go up to the wall and they go up to certain distance and come back. Next. So mathematical description becomes more and more difficult. So here, there is a formation of boundary layer, stays for some time, and it is swiped out. And again, boundary layer is formed. And therefore, periodic growth and breakdown theory. Next slide. Reality is this. And people tried to capture by some analytical equation, equal contact time, exponentially decaying contact time, and see the reality. Correct? Next. So now the characteristic features are the flow near the wall is unsteady, three-dimensional. Wall normal ejections are there. That is, eddies are going towards the wall and they are moving away from the wall. So all these details, the conclusion which I told you in between, the same thing is written here. The turbulent mixing of fluid elements from wall region with turbulent core occurs due to instability in the viscosity domain. So all these complexities are not understood. Next slide. So maybe I'll make it faster than that, faster than the way in which I am teaching. So if we really solve equations of continuity, motion and energy, where the dimension over which we get distance is up to say 5 microns, 2 microns, 1 micron, and solve the equation up to that, means what? The solution of ordinary differential equation you have studied, Runge-Kutta you have studied. So for that you assume certain delta x, you have a boundary condition, and therefore at delta x you find the value, from that for next delta x you find the value. So if this delta x is taken, say 5 microns, then you know velocity with respect to time at all these locations. And this is called direct numerical simulations. So until then, computational fluid dynamics was being used, but the values of u prime, v prime, for which we wanted the answer, those were modeled, again, by making several assumptions. If we had a time, we may get time, but it is not important. The point I'm trying to emphasize is how the subject has been developed and the computational fluid dynamics with direct numerical simulations, even for pipe flow or flow past sphere, is being understood right now. At least that much effort is there. Forget about fluidized bed, forget about packed column. A single particle or flow through pipeline, the detailed flow, the motion of all the eddies is being understood. The student who is sitting here, he is doing flow past a spherical particle, Shashank, and struggling for that. But what is the size of the grid, up to what size you have gone? For a single particle. Point? 180 million is the number of grids, but what is the size of the grid in the vicinity? Few microns, part of micron, or it is a fraction of micron, 0.01 or 0. 10 raised to minus 8 meters, right? So 0.01 micron, 0.5 micron. So every 0.5 micron, what is the velocity and what is the delta t? 10 raised to minus 7 seconds. So every 10 raised to minus 7 second, and at every place which is 0.0508 micron, what is the velocity? And this has happened mainly because of the computational power that we have. And this has permitted to understand we now don't need eddy size distribution and velocity distribution, mainly because we actually know what are the local values, right? And that is, so let us go, this is the reality, next. So with the help of, before direct numerical simulation, there was a technique called large eddy simulation, which also had assumptions, several assumptions. But it could go up to certain distance. Next slide. This I will not explain. What is the meaning of direct numerical simulation? Next slide. So this is what Sachin did. By direct numerical simulations, up to Schmidt number of 8, no assumption, no velocity assumption, he solved in complete detail. But now there is a possibility to go at least up to flow past sphere, we can go even up to 10,000, and in the definitely in a pipeline up to 10,000. So detailed flow using direct numerical simulation, it is possible. So the science is developed how to get detailed fluid mechanics in the vicinity of interface, but for simple geometries like pipe flow or flow past a spherical particle or flow past a single cylinder. If we take actual multiphase, but people have started for multi-particle systems. Our group itself has solved for 800 particles, right? 200. So before 800, the students must have done five particles, 10 particles, then got up to 800 particles. So maybe in a period of another 10 years, the estimation of the design parameters will become under control. Until then, so the conclusion I said, I promised you I'll say at the end, right now we have to be satisfied with empiricism mainly because the fluid mechanics at the interface are not understood. There have been efforts, but there are several assumptions, and therefore we need to resort to empiricism, and the best practice right now is pick up the best one recommended in handbooks, but try to get proportionality constant for our purpose, for our equipment, for our multiphase system under consideration, develop proportionality constant and use it for scale up. I'm not going to ask you, have you understood? But still the faces still look smiling. They still look smiling. So I'm stopping here, the entire course. You are welcome to tell me. I had promised something which you must have written on the last page. You are free to ask me. Or even a small group of 4 or 5 students, they decide to ask me something as a small group discussion, that is also welcome. You can talk to Shashank, who sits in Professor Ashwin Patwardhan's laboratory, which you know, and then you can tell him that these are our difficulties, and then I will definitely give time. About anything we have learned up till now, I'm sure I might have taught you for 32, 33 hours all put together. I'm taking approximately 3 hours, not today. Today it is 2 hours, approximately 2 hours, yeah. Otherwise, I'm going to tell you, wish you all the best in your life. Remember 2 things, never complain in life and remain smiling. Keep these 2 things. Those who complain, their energy level, thinking level, creativity level is very poor. And they achieve very little in the life. The reverse of not complaining is keep smiling. It is the same thing. And you shall be successful with the help of these 2 qualities. All the best to you.